Welcome to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Michael W. Dean of the Freedom Fiends cooks up a very special blend of liberty, guns, sex, rock and roll, drugs, and thriving in spite of the state in an increasingly worrying world. All with a rotating cast of nifty guests who are also up in the middle of the night.
So, welcome to another episode of Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Today we're having a conversation with Stephanie Murphy. A conversation, not an interview, I always say.
I like that better.
It's like an interview, but I get to talk more than in an interview, I guess. People aren't baffled when I go blah, 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 after what they say.
It's a virtual hangout, maybe?
Yeah. We're talking over Mumble, which is, we're having all sorts of weird little issues getting synced up, but we got it going. What is Mumble? Talk about Mumble.
Mumble. It's a way to talk that's basically low latency, so you connect to a server and you can talk to anybody all over the world. And we also use it, Michael, we both do live shows on the Liberty Radio Network, so we use it to send our voices to LRN when we do our live shows.
Yep. It's the easy way to describe it, I say, is it's like Skype, but sounds better and it's more secure.
Yeah, I agree on both.
I think Liberty people should have a way to do secure, encrypted communications as things get more and more intrusive, you know?
Yeah, there's been a lot of talk about that I've heard anyway. Are you familiar with like some of the instant messaging things like Pigeon, you know, that you can go off the record and encrypt your IMs?
No, I haven't used that. I used encrypted email for a while, PGP. The problem was I couldn't find anyone to use it with.
Yeah.
You know.
I think most people realize, ooh, I heard a noise.
I will turn that off. That's my email.
Cool. Did you get a secure encrypted email?
I got an unsecure email from Nima Vadati saying, the files are in the FTP server from the other podcast I did earlier today.
Nice.
Yep.
Well, anyway, about the email, the secure encrypted stuff, I think that most people realize that when you send an email, it's more like a postcard than anything really secure.
Yeah.
But they don't care.
Yeah, especially with the thing they're building in Utah to read everyone's email.
I heard about this. Isn't it like they're going to hire like 200,000 people to staff this thing and they're going to read like every email on the internet?
Yeah, something like that. And they say that they're working towards being able to break encrypted email, but if you use like, you know, 2,000-bit encryption or something, there's no way it's ever going to get broken. There's just no way. And even if it were, it would take a lot of work for each one. And the thing is that I think is people should be using encryption even if they're just talking about the weather. And there's a lot of reasons for that. The main one, though, is that if only people doing secret stuff that would be weird are using email, then that's going to be easy to go, oh, you're doing the weird stuff. But if everybody's using it, it's hard to tell.
Yeah, definitely. I've even heard people say, like, everybody should basically release their social security numbers out to the internet so that anyone could kind of like steal their identity, then they could say, oh, well, it wasn't me, it was on the internet, anyone could have done this.
I don't know if I'd
I don't know what you'd really use
I don't know if
it
I'd
for,
take
but...
that angle. I use a secure browser sometimes called Tor, and one of the in the Tor readme file, one of the things it says is get everyone you can to use Tor, because the more people with the more diverse interests using Tor in a select geographic area, the harder it's going to be to say, oh, this is the guy that was reading about insurrection or whatever, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And the same thing goes for Bitcoins, I think. There are like a lot of people who sort of associate them maybe with buying drugs on the Silk Road or prostitutes or whatever. But like if people use them for all different kinds of things, then nobody can say that anymore.
Yeah. Have you got you take Bitcoins as contributions, right? Have you gotten any Bitcoin contributions?
Yeah, I do have a Bitcoin contribution thing for my show Porc Therapy, and I have gotten a lot of Bitcoin. Not a lot, but you know, a couple different people throwing me some Bitcoins. It's pretty cool.
Part of the problem with alternative currencies and communication methods and encryption is just getting people to use it. You know, like someone the other day said they wanted to make a donation to the Freedom Fiends and they wanted to send a little bit of silver. And it was like, I felt embarrassed because I actually found myself thinking kind of out loud in my head, like, why can't they just send money? You know, and it's like, no, they want to send me something real of value. And I'm like, no, send me a PayPal, you know, send me a digital scan, you know, a digital imaginary number instead. But I gave him my P.O. box and he's sending it.
Yeah, I mean, the disadvantage of getting silver is like it can be inconvenient, I guess, but with PayPal, they're going to skim some off the top, and you'll always be able to track it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Bitcoins avoid all that, you know. It's like you can do international transactions with no overhead fees and no hassle. Just send them and forget it.
Yeah. I've not put my toe in that pond yet. But so tell us a little about you, for anyone who doesn't know the majesty of Stephanie Murphy. what are you all about, and what are some of your URLs and projects?
Oh, cool. Well, I have a lot of different projects, but basically I'm a person who likes liberty. I'm into freedom, especially kind of freeing our minds and like the ideas of personal liberty, I guess. Like, how can we be more free in our own lives right now, no matter where we are? Although I did move to New Hampshire for the Free State Project in 2006. I've been there ever since. I was one of the earliest early movers.
Where did you move from?
Massachusetts, so it wasn't too far away.
Yeah, but that's a pretty big move in a way. I mean, it's like the least free state to the most free state, or one of the most free states.
It was a noticeable difference, let's put it that way. I could tell when I moved to New Hampshire. Basically, I'm, like I said, I'm interested in freedom in a lot of different ways, and that's kind of what my show Porc Therapy is about. It's PORC therapy, if you want to hear my podcast, which it's not just a podcast, it's a live radio show, and I also do put out some like bonus content that's podcast only, but we talk about just freeing your mind, all kinds of personal liberty stuff. It's a really interesting conversation. I always have fun doing it. And then I'm also involved with Free Talk Live. I co-host that show with Mark Edge every Sunday night, and Free Talk Live is another radio show. They're more like radio based. They have a lot of different stations that they're on, affiliates, but they're also an internet show too, and they put all their podcasts out there for free, just like I do. And they talk about kind of current events from like a liberty perspective. So those are my two projects that people might know me from, I guess you could say.
You have more things than that going on. I could tell the things. You've forgotten you have so many things going on. What else you got going on?
Should I talk about free aid? I'm a medical student. I'm in an MD PhD program. And
is that you're going to be a doctor or a head doctor or?
When I started out, like, my goal was basically to make new cures for diseases. Like, I wanted to use technology to find out new things and cure diseases. And what I found along the way after 6 years of being in that world is that it's pretty hard. You know, the government makes it really hard to do that, you know. It's very entwined with science and medicine. And so it's been frustrating at times, but I've kept a lot of other interests sort of like outside of that world too.
I mean,
but,
are you going to be a psychiatrist, a psychologist, or a medical doctor, or what?
Studying to be a medical doctor, but I could go into psychiatry, I guess, if I, like, with an MD.
You got other stuff going on.
Yeah. So I was talking about the medicine and science thing, and one of my projects is Free Aid that I'm involved in right now. And Free Aid is fr33aid.com. It's a mutual aid organization, and it's meant to basically like promote mutual aid and educate people about sort of basic first aid stuff that they can do to help themselves or help their neighbors, because you really can't always rely on things like ambulances to come in time. Like, if somebody has a cardiac arrest, it really helps if other people are around who know how to do CPR and things like that. So free aid kind of shows up at different liberty events, like with the Porcupine Freedom Festival, and we went to Libertopia this year and Liberty Forum and others, and we do some outreach to people about CPR and just provide general kind of volunteer first aid at those events.
There was a kind of hippie version of that a long time ago in San Francisco. I think it was called Rock Medicine. Do you know about them?
No, but I'm familiar with, there are lots of like street medics, you know, and especially with the rise of the Occupy movement, there are lots of people going around and just doing first aid for free to people.
Is that is that connected with free agents, FR33 agents?
It was. It kind of stemmed from the same roots, I guess. The old free agents version 1.0 was like kind of a social network. And we got the idea to sort of do free aid as a branch of that, but then free agents kind of reinvented themselves, so free aid isn't really as involved, I guess, with free agents 2.0, but we definitely share the FR33 thing.
Don't you do another podcast? Aren't you a regular on Dale's show?
Not so much anymore, but I was on it like this past weekend, and that's Flaming Freedom. I'd like to be on Flaming Freedom more often, but since he moved his studio, it's been a little harder for me to get there. But yeah, I definitely am very interested in LGBT issues. I'm a bisexual woman, and that sort of started off my interest, but just in general, I really like to work with Dale. I like his show, so it's other reasons for being on there too.
It used to be called Prometheus Unchained, right?
Mm-hmm. And they changed it. They always had the URL of flamingfreedom.com. I don't know really why they chose to call it Prometheus Unchained.
No one could spell Prometheus. That's why they probably changed it.
And there's some movie called Prometheus too, so maybe people got confused with that.
Hmm. Is that all? You got more? You got more, don't you? That's a lot. You got a job, too. What do you do for work?
I do. Well, I'm in school, so I'm working on getting a PhD right now. So that's like a full-time commitment. So I'm really doing like 8 million full-time things at once right now. So I'm pretty busy.
Bye. So how did you get into Liberty, and how long ago did that happen? And what's your journey? What was your journey?
Wow. Well, the first thing I rejected was religion. I was raised Jewish, and a lot of the stuff that I learned in synagogue really just didn't, I always questioned it from the very beginning. I never felt like I fit in. I was really upset with the idea that we were being taught to like speak this other language, Hebrew, which we didn't, we were taught to like pronounce it, but we didn't know what it meant. And that always really bothered me. And I just questioned a lot of things about that. So around 13, maybe, I decided I was not interested in being religious, and so I became an atheist, and I started looking at atheist websites because the internet was kind of like nascent then. This was maybe, you know, back in the early 90s. So somehow that led me to like sort of pro-freedom websites, like libertarian oriented ones, because there are some atheists are like skeptics who are kind of more like left-leaning, you know, like they want the government to do certain things, but they want to keep religion out of the government. But then there are some that are more liberty oriented. You're laughing because you know what I mean.
Yeah.
So somehow I found some liberty-oriented websites, and then I started reading. Like I read Atlas Shrugged like pretty early on, got some ideas from Ayn Rand, and then I started reading like LouRockwell.com and the Mises Institute like years after that when they were sort of coming up, and got a lot of foundation from that. And then I sort of, you know, those were great like educational tools, and I learned a lot about economics and a lot about politics and anti-war issues and stuff like that, but they really, I think we're missing something on the personal side of liberty. So then I became interested in that, and I started really doing some like self-work and introspection and learning more about psychology, and so that's sort of how I came to where I am today. And I think that those personal issues are, I maybe started a little bit backwards. Like I think the personal side of liberty is even more important to free your mind before you start worrying about the Federal Reserve and the economy and a lot of the things that you can't control. You know, work on your relationships and work on yourself.
That came up in your video you did with Stefan Molyneux, that same idea right there of not worrying about the Federal Reserve until you get your own house in order with relationships.
Yeah, I think that's an idea that Stefan talks about a lot. And I know you had him on the show. I actually heard your interview with him, which was really good.
it was controversial. A lot of, he put it up on YouTube, and there's a very
because of the kink thing?
Interesting array of comments. The kink thing, which I'd love to touch on with you, because we had a discussion about that previously.
Yeah.
And I think just because I was kind of irreverent or fun with him, and I think people take, not him, but other, you know, a lot of people take liberty really seriously, and I was like joking with him and saying worms, and people were like, what is this? You cannot speak to the master and say worms. But it
really,
also,
there were people,
oh yeah,
people who were weirded out by that.
Yeah, there's a bunch of comments on the YouTube thing of like, I don't like this worm stuff, and then like people were saying that they were surprised I didn't ask him to go surfing like I'm Spicoli, like some dude or something, I don't know. I think that the last 10 minutes of that, which he I think it was the best I've ever heard from him, and I think he may have thought
he
so
was
too
on fire.
He put up the whole video, but he also put up just that last 10 minutes of it where he was, I've never heard him so angry. It was a beautiful thing. He was screaming at the world, which, you know, there's reason to do that.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you just want to rant at the world, huh?
Yeah, and I think the question that tipped him off to that, which I'll ask you later, talk more about your journey, though. You didn't finish your journey, I don't think.
I pretty much did. Like, I've been trying to sum it up succinctly, but that's basically how I ended up where I am today. And I'm sure it's going to continue. There's no end to the path, I guess, of trying to achieve as much freedom as you can in your life, you know. That's pretty much it.
Yeah. And I think that the personal should enter more into discussion. I mean, that's one thing Stefan said, was like, wow, this has never come up, and I think there should be more discussions of sex or human relationships in Freedom Talk, because a lot of Freedom Talk is really analytical and theoretical, and a lot more of it is how people deal with each other on a daily one-to-one basis, and not just in sex, but in, you know, how you treat your neighbor. And I've blocked a lot of people on social networks. On Facebook, for instance, I have about 65 people blocked. And the only reason I've ever blocked anybody is because they've been a prick to me. I mean, I may bring that out of people, but I don't care what, I'll talk to anybody. I mean, I have friends on there that I talk to daily who are avowed socialists and think that the government should be way more controlling than it is. And I'll still talk to them. And I have blocked libertarian deists who believe what I believed, like 99.999% about the world, but they're just mean, you know. As soon as someone starts yelling, I'm gone.
Yeah, so you need to be talked to in a way that's like basically respectful and polite.
Yeah. I mean, I have friends who are out stumping for Obama door to door right now, although I'm kind of embarrassed by it, but you know,
yeah, I mean, I'm actually very skeptical of ostracism. Like, if you hear me on some of the shows, I talk about this occasionally. It's okay, of course. Like, I could support distancing yourself from somebody because, like, you know, maybe you've tried to resolve conflicts or, you know, told them some stuff like that, but it's just not working, or, you know, you need a break from somebody. Sure, that's fine, but I don't think ostracism is like the cure-all that everybody seems to say it is, especially in the liberty movement. It's like, well, if somebody does a crime or if somebody's mean to you, you just ostracize them until they die, basically. And I think that's a little bit of a simplistic view.
Well, I mean, that gets into the how would you deal with crime, real crime in libertarian paradise. But I'm talking more about just cutting people out that aren't good.
I think people, especially libertarians, tend to take that idea of ostracizing people who really do crimes that violate the non-aggression principle, and they start to apply it to their personal lives. And they're like, well, if somebody crosses a line with me, I'm just not going to talk to them anymore. And, you know, maybe that works, like, especially for some people. But I tend to think that maybe mediation is kind of underutilized, don't you think? Like,
well, people, are we talking about breaking into your neighbor's car, or are we talking about
being an
asshole on the internet or to someone's face?
We're talking about a political debate that happens on the internet, or, you know, an interpersonal conflict between people. Not like a theft or a injuring of somebody. Those are kind of different. That wasn't what I was thinking of, but yeah.
Are you saying that you, when people are rude to you on the internet, you keep them around and let them keep being rude to you?
I don't know. I mean, I try to keep my discussions on the internet at a level that it doesn't get rude. Like, I kind of try to be nice to people, and usually they're nice in return.
I don't.
Well, are you laughing at me?
I don't. I don't know, because I'm laughing because it sounds like you don't have that many people blocked on Facebook as I do.
I don't think I have anybody blocked on Facebook, actually.
Yeah, Nima laughs at me for having so many people blocked. He's blocked, like, one person, and it was someone who was giving him, like, racist death threats. And I'm like, wow. People don't have to go that far to get... I mean, I kind of look at it like the internet, to me, is kind of like a virtual space of my home. You know, like my parts on the internet, where I go and where I hang out, I kind of look at it like a party in my living room. And if somebody was knocking things over and being rude to people and grabbing people and pushing people and shoving people, I'd throw them out of a party in my living room and not let them back.
Yeah. And racist death threats, like, certainly, I understand. I would want to get away from that person if that was coming to me. You know what I mean? I would want to just distance myself as much as possible.
Yeah.
But, you know, I've posted things online that people didn't like and maybe responded pretty in a way that I considered pretty rude, you know, but I let them say what they wanted to say, and I made my points and let them speak for themselves. I mean, you know.
I just like blocking people. I don't know. I'm older. How old are you? I'm older. I've had more people mess with me. I've been around longer.
I'm 27, so yeah.
I'm 47. When I was 27, when I was your age, no, when I was your age, I had like no filter for humans. I let everyone into my life, and you're smarter than that now, but no, I let everyone in my life when I was 27. I'm glad the internet didn't exist then for me.
Yeah, I would say I definitely have standards like about who I really want to spend my time with, because my time is so limited. Like, I'm just so busy that I don't have too much social time, and so I have really kind of pared down like who I'm really close to, I guess, and who I spend the most time with. And most of that is libertarians, you know, people who share like at least some of my views.
Yeah, it's really hard to like have someone close as a friend who's not a libertarian for me now.
Mm-hmm.
I just they want to rob me by proxy. I'm still friends with a few of them, but it's hard.
Yeah, I know. I find my pie is like getting narrower and narrower. Like, it's almost like the people I most want to, you know, spend the most time with are like even specific types of libertarians, you know. Yeah. So I do, I wouldn't say like I'm so accepting of everybody that I just all the time hang out with statists who I have nothing in common with. No, that's not what I'm trying to say. It's just like, I just think that people are sometimes too quick to use ostracism, you know, and too quick to cut others out of their lives when maybe that relationship, like whatever happened, could be resolved and like could be addressed in a way that's peaceful.
Well, I do not use ostracism much. I mean, I do with like people.
Is blocking ostracism? Is
no,
it blocking on? Okay.
No, it's removing something from your life which is only going to cause trouble.
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, I ostracize, like, you know, I'll ostracize Eric Holder and Cass Sunstein and Obama Baraka and you know, Santorum, but they're not really real people to me. They're fictions or something.
Yeah, I can see that. It's sort of more like a persona.
Yeah.
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 You're listening to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast, a tasty stew of freedom and fun. Subscribe at kittyfeet.com. That's kittyfeet.com.
How are you this fine day again after our first break?
I feel great. I did a little stretching. I had a workout before we started to record. I'm into fitness. That's another thing I guess we could talk about.
Yeah, you were saying, I'm hot and sweaty when we started out. And I was like, wow, a lot of information there.
That was my mic check.
Yep. Oh, okay. That was not for public dissemination.
Oh, no, that's fine. That's okay. I will be teaching some yoga classes at Porcfest, at the Porcupine Freedom Festival.
Yeah. I won't probably be at Porcupine Freedom Festival. I would if it were up the street. But
yeah, I understand. I know you don't. You have some apprehensions about traveling, right? Like where you have to be disarmed going through certain states.
That is a big part of it. The other part of it is I don't think I'd want to go without my wife, and she gets about 8 vacation days a year, and we tend to spend them with family. So,
yep, that makes sense.
With
well,
her family,
it's a fun time. I wish Porcfest were something that happened in more different places or events like it anyway. Or I wish that maybe you could like video hang out during Porcfest. I know they were talking about that.
You know, I should get my friend Garrett's going, and I'm sort of his like pod mentor. Like I taught him
Garrett
everything I know
about.
Oh,
Garrett from the disinformation.
Disindoctrination podcast.
Yeah, disindoctrination. Sorry,
yeah.
Garrett.
My wife actually named that podcast. It used to be called something else, and we were spitballing, and DJ came up with that. I like the name.
Oh, cool. It's,
but maybe I'll get him to set up a little Skype cam where people can Skype in who aren't there. That'd be fun.
I bet that could work. You just have to make sure that sometimes the internet up there is a little spotty, but I think we could probably make it work.
Yeah, except who there would want to hang out in front of that camera and talk to the losers who don't make it? It'd probably just be people walking by and you know, smoking a joint and laughing at the camera. Ha ha, you're not here.
Oh, it doesn't make you a loser because you can't go. It's just, you know, different priorities.
Yep. So I heard a really funny term for an advice column. You do you do kind of an advice show, right?
Sort of. Like, if people want to ask me questions, I'll answer, but I don't really feel like qualified, I guess, to give advice, so I try to stay away from it. I just kind of discuss the questions, I guess.
The I heard the British term for an advice column in a newspaper is an agony aunt or agony uncle column. Like, where people people bring their agony to the aunt who tells them what to do.
That's an interesting term.
Yep. I think it's funny.
Yeah, agony aunt.
I try to not give advice either when people ask for advice. I went through AA. I'm still sober. I don't go anymore, but I learned a lot from it. And one of the things in AA they say is they don't give advice. They give experience, strength, and hope. And that's kind of, I like that. Mm. Yep.
Yeah, I like that too. Definitely. I've heard you talk about your experiences with AA before, and it's always been interesting to me. I'm very interested in how to, you know, like, overcome addictions and stuff and sort of free yourself from that. I think that's like one of the major things that weighs a lot of people down is just being addicted to things, whether it's alcohol or other things. I mean, people can kind of get addicted to anything. Like, I was actually an obese teenager, and I think I was really had some elements of like food addiction. Like, I would eat not because I was hungry, but because I was sad, you know, or other reasons. And so I think sort of learning to recognize like why we get addicted to things and what we can do about it is really important for personal freedom.
I agree. That's, you know, one thing I am intrigued with about Stefan Molyneux's whole thing is his defoo, you know, his leaving your family of origin, which he's taken a lot of heat for. But I mean, that kind of goes along with my like blocking people on the internet or something. It's like, no, if somebody is just mean to me or has non-voluntary interactions with me every time they deal with me, whether it's, you know, someone saying, fuck you, I'm going to kill you because of your skin color, or something really subtle, like we often have, like people often have in families where it's passive aggressive and ingrained and, you know, I mean, that's something that I'm interested in just getting away from. And it was interesting to find someone else who's coming from a liberty standpoint who talks about that.
Yeah, and I think what he says about that probably gets misinterpreted a lot. Like, a lot of people are out there on the internet saying, oh, he's a cult, he's preying on young people and telling them to get away from their families. But no, that's not true. Really, he's just kind of talking about the idea of, hey, if you've had a really abusive childhood, if you can't reconcile with your parents, if you've tried to work it out, and if it's just not working for some reason, one option is to not talk to them. You know, I really think that's what he's saying. He's not telling everybody to stop talking to their parents by any means, even though that's what some people would claim.
Well, the BBC did a piece on him that was sensationalized, that tried to, you know, get eyeballs by exaggerating and misinterpreting him.
Yeah, because I guess some, you know, a kid or a young adult stopped talking to his parents, and his parents sort of found out that he had been listening to Stefan's show, and then they kind of started to blame him for it. Found some stuff in his forums.
I don't think that's being cult-like. I think that's being emo.
Well, yeah. I mean, how many teenagers or young adults have sort of rocky relationships with their parents anyway? I mean, maybe they don't completely cut off contact, but the state of things as they are like now, if Stefan's podcast like never existed, a lot of kids don't talk to their parents very much.
Yeah. And I think that people probably also decide to run away at 18 like that kid did, you know, after listening to some band that has meaningful lyrics to them, but the parents can't understand what they're saying, whereas with Stefan or with a podcast, people can understand what the person's saying.
Mm. Yeah, it could be.
So I kind of got into it with Stefan about something he said about BDSM, and it was interesting to me because the things I was saying to him were almost... some of it was almost word for word a series of emails I'd sent to you about 4 months earlier.
Was it 4 months ago?
I don't know, 6 months. You think it was less or more?
I think it was less, but maybe it was. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe I send so many emails and talk to so many people that it just seems like longer. I don't know. But you and Dale had been talking about BDSM on your show. Yeah, it was one of the web-only after-party talks. And
yeah,
he'd said some things negative about BDSM that I felt were uninformed, and you said them to a lesser extent or agreed with him or didn't disagree with him. And I wrote in defense of, hey, that's not accurate. And what exactly did you say? I don't want to paraphrase you, if you can remember.
Well, what I said and what other people heard were two different things. That's entirely possible, you know. But really, I was just interested in exploring this question of, like, sort of, you know, why might somebody be interested in kink, and could it be possible that there are other reasons than maybe it's just fun or that's something I like? And, you know, I'm not telling anybody answers or anything like that to those questions. I ask myself lots of different questions every day about everything from my orientation to why I became a scientist to all kinds of things. So it just doesn't hurt to do some introspection about anything in your life, really. But I think that what Dale was saying, I think, was that he's had some experience with BDSM, and from his experience, he sort of questions, you know, maybe whether 100% of it was coming from a healthy place for him. So that's what we talked about.
Well, my half-joking answer to that would be he wasn't doing it right then. And what I mean by that is, if someone actually wanted... Okay, if someone was not kinky and they experimented with kink with someone who was kinky, they'd probably have a negative reaction to it. But I'm assuming that he has some stirrings towards that, or he wouldn't have been there in the first place. So he may have been with somebody who wasn't doing it in a way that he liked.
I think he was the top.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. He sounded really negative about it. I mean, he definitely brought up the thing of, I think that people who do this do it because they were abused, which I don't agree with. And he also just, it was hard. He was kind of hemming and hawing more than I am right now, even. So it's hard to really remember exactly what he was saying, but it definitely had a feeling of, this is something bad or dark or not good or indicative of abuse or something.
Yeah, and I would say to that, like, maybe we were doing it wrong in terms of talking about it on the podcast, like you just said that he was doing it wrong. We were doing it wrong if it came off to sound like we're prescribing something or telling people what to do or making a diagnosis or judging people or anything like that. I mean,
he was really diagnosing himself, though. It wasn't someone calling in. It was, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, what the point of that show for me was to just explore it and ask some questions. And, you know, one of the things that we discussed is, like, I think I saw this article the other day that said something like 60% of people are interested in like light bondage, basically, like being tied up or something like that, or tying somebody else up. And when it becomes 60% of people that are interested in something, it's no longer the minority. And
I know.
What is even defined as kink? Like, what do you define as kink? I mean, I think you're a pretty kinky person, right, from what you've said. But how do you define that? I mean, because to me, there might be a difference, especially a difference of degrees, between somebody who likes to be a little bit tied up once in a while and somebody who is into, like, scat or vomit or something like that, or wants to pretend that they're getting murdered or, you know, something like that.
Well, first of all, my hard limits, which, you know, isn't really your business or anyone listening's business, but I'll say the things that creep me out that I never wanted anything to do with is, like, children, animals, scat, or blood. Anything else was fair game. But, okay. And yeah, I mean, BDSM, you know, it used to be called S&M or DS, you know, dominant submission. BDSM is actually an acronym that means it's kind of three sets of things.
It's a compound acronym. Bond, yeah.
Bond, that's a good
bondage,
word.
Bondage/domination.
Yeah. Dominance and submission and sadomasochism.
Oh, excuse me. Bondage/discipline. I always screw that up. Domination, yep. Submission, and sadism, masochism.
Yeah, and if you're really a protocol queen, the first letter of each of those three groups is capital, and the one after the slash is small. Well, I never got that. I never got that much into the rules, but Yeah, I mean, it's funny because a lot of people who decry BDSM probably practice it without knowing that, because that compound acronym is so inclusive that it includes everything from, you know, at the heaviest point, you know, having someone stick needles in your genitals while bullwhipping you to the point of bleeding in a room full of strangers watching you, to the other end of the spectrum would be, you know, hey baby, hands at your side, let me drive, which, you know, basically anything where one person is having a little bit of control in bed over the other person and the other person's letting them. And I think most people who don't go to Rick Santorum's church have probably practiced some kind of sex like that.
Maybe a lot of people who do go to Rick Santorum's church have practiced that, because I think it, so basically, if I'm hearing you right, Michael, you have a very all-inclusive definition of kink, like any kind of power exchange could be considered BDSM.
Yeah, any kind of power exchange, or, you know, for the psychological standpoint or from the physical standpoint, basically anything that's not, you know, hetero missionary facing each other for procreation, I would include in that.
Yeah, and I wouldn't disparage that either. I mean, I wouldn't disparage missionary or heterosexuality or anything like that. I think when I hear kinky people say like vanilla, it's almost like, oh, that's boring or whatever. And maybe to some people it is, but some people it isn't. And to each their own. There's a wide range of what's normal and what's, like, you know, what people do in terms of sex, for sure.
I've had a lot of sex with a lot of women and a few men, and done every possible position and variation I could think of, and I'm a pretty creative guy, and I must say that some of the best times I've ever had were missionary facing each other, not for procreation, but I guess the reason I'm kind of on this tear lately with liberty people of, first of all, nobody ever asks anyone about sex in interviews on liberty stuff. They always want to talk about the Federal Reserve or, you know, silver or the non-aggression the non-aggression principle.
Yeah, and that's true. We might as well make this interesting, right, Michael?
Yeah,
people want to listen to it.
Yeah, I mean, the internet is really, you know, built on sex and cute cat pictures. You know, what else is there in life? So I guess basically the reason I brought it up with you and with Stefan, and I would with Dale if he'd ever answer my emails. I mean, I CC'd him on the emails I was sending you, and he didn't write back. So
I saw him write back a couple times.
He wrote back once and said, I don't know what you're referring to. And I wrote him back and clarified, and then he didn't write back. So unless there was another one,
I think I remembered him really like listening back to the podcast and really listening to your concerns. Huh. That was what I remembered anyway, but I don't know.
I guess the reason I'm bringing it up with libertarian rock stars like you and Dale and Stefan, you know, people that have an audience that are giving advice, is to clarify, because I'm kind of not appalled, but kind of like, ugh, of the idea of someone who is liberty minded and, hey baby.
Hello.
Welcome home from work.
Thank you.
Love you. Sorry, hang on a
second. Hi DJ, can I say hi?
yeah, she won't hear you, but
tell her I said hi.
Stephanie says hi. Hello. It's the two ladies with very similar
We need to
voices.
Team up at some point. I would love to work with her on something.
You do. We'll write something and have it. We've been doing little like 60-second humorous Liberty commercials lately. Maybe we can have you both on one of those. Yeah, actually there was somebody, I think there was a kink store commercial on Free Talk Live that there was like a coin flip of you or her voicing it.
I got asked to voice that, and I wasn't comfortable doing it.
That was it.
Yeah.
There you go. You didn't want to blush on the air.
Well, it sort of like it would run on Free Talk Live, and it would sort of sound like maybe I was
endorsing.
It was an endorsement or something.
Like one of those Hannity things where Hannity's doing his ranting and then goes into, and that's why the economy is collapsing. So you need to invest your money at this company where they'll store the gold for you. Yeah,
yeah.
That's how he does ads. But so anyway, I guess it's like, for me, BDSM has been a source of liberation in the same way that, like, some people take psychedelic drugs to free their mind or expand their consciousness. I've found that through BDSM. And then I hear liberty people saying, oh, BDSM is bad. And I'm like, yeah? Yeah, I mean, some, you know, people take drugs to expand their mind or participate in tribal dance to expand their mind or look to religion or any of the things that people do throughout the ages to get somewhere else. You know, I heard somewhere a long time ago, it was in this book about drugs and why people take drugs, and it said that mankind basically has two basic needs. One is to have things stay the same, and the other is to have things different. And the stay the same urge is the, you know, having shelter, having food, having a house that won't blow away in a tornado, having friends that won't betray you, having money to live. Those are the needs to stay the same. And once those are met, what's that that triangle of human need? Do you know the thing I'm talking about?
Are you talking about Maslow's hierarchy of needs?
Yeah, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You know, there is not drugs in one of those, but there is kind of a, like, entertainment, or I don't remember it offhand, but there's a...
Novelty, perhaps?
Yeah, novelty. There you go. Uh-huh. But for me, like, sex throughout my life has been more than novelty. It's almost been a spiritual pursuit or a way to get to spirituality. And... Mm-hmm. Non-standard sex for me has brought me to that place time and time again. So to hear liberty people saying, oh, that's bad, I'm like, wait a minute, come on, let's... And I got taken to task for it, you know, by a lot of Stefan's fans, like, on that video, you know, they were like, hey, great interview, except for that weird stuff in the middle about that guy's sex life. Why did I have to hear about that? And I'm like... I know.
I'm sorry. I really cringe when I hear them kind of judging you about that. And I thought it was really vulnerable of you to talk about it so openly. And I really actually appreciated that very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. And I hear you. I hear you about the novelty. I really do. Please go ahead. Finish your thought, because I have some thoughts.
Go
too.
Ahead.
Well, you know, I think that you're right that it does seem... I could see how somebody might hear a liberty person talking about kink in maybe a not so positive light and then think, oh, well, they're trying to control me or they're trying to tell me what to do. And I do want to emphasize that I don't want to control anybody or tell anybody what to do, or of course, you know, use the government to tell anybody what to do. Like, that's not something I'm interested in. Okay, so here's something I want to talk about. We said a minute ago that, like, some of the people who go to Rick Santorum's church, you know, they're not likely to be doing kinky stuff in bed, right? Did you say that?
Well, and you said they probably are.
Yeah, and I want to expand on that, because the more that I've learned about hierarchy and about the state and about basically systems of control where one person has power over another and it's non-consensual, you know, like you're just kind of born into a situation where somebody is dominant over you, or is an authority, I guess, or so-called authority, and is forcing you to do things. The more I've learned about that, the more I've wanted to be sort of free from it as a libertarian, you know, and sort of the more I've questioned, maybe I've seen the parallels between some of the things in kink or BDSM and some of those domination systems that are in our world, you know, our non-sexual world, that are not consensual. And I've started to kind of think about that a little bit and associate it and just wonder if some people are kind of translating that stuff that they've learned to sex or not. Maybe not. I mean, it's a question that we can all ask ourselves, and maybe the answer is no, maybe it has nothing to do with that. But, you know, that's kind of what I wanted to do during that show.
You're wondering if people that are into kink are acting like the state with their partner?
Well, almost. Just that they learn that, like, relationships are hierarchical, or relationships have one person who's on top and one person who's on the bottom, because that's the way the state treats it. I mean, I'm not trying to like ruin kink or make it unsexy or anything like that, but you have to say, like, the state, we are the state's sub in some ways, you know, the way they treat us, and it's not consensual. That's of course.
Well,
I'd say we're
the state's slave, not sub, and there is a difference. But
okay, fair enough. Point taken.
And not even, I mean, a slave in the sense of a BDSM relationship isn't really a slave, because it's agreeing to be a slave, and there is an out if you want to leave. You know, a divorce in kink, you know, a kink relationship ending is easier than a marriage release. I mean, it's you agree to just go your separate ways. Mm-hmm. I've actually found that people in kink tend to be less psychotic sexually than vanilla people, less likely to like stalk the person if they try to leave, less likely to be controlling if they try to leave.
I don't agree with that either, by the way. Like jealousy, I think jealousy and the whole idea of like sort of viewing a partner as property is a big problem in the way that a lot of people's, you know, relationships are, romantic relationships in this world.
Yeah. And, you know, the thing about, you were talking about like people in power and wondering if people are acting like the state in their bedroom. Well, that was my phrasing, but I think that's what you're going at with kink. I think that that would probably be true not in lifestyle relationships like I'm in with my wife, but more so in like pro-dame stuff. Like, you know, the cliche of the powerful businessman or politician relaxing by going and paying some woman to whip him or, you know, step on his genitals with high heels. That's real, because I've known in San Francisco, I knew a bunch of women who were pro dames, which I think has very little to do with lifestyle BDSM. You know, it's a whole different thing. It's a monetary arrangement for power, and the people that do it aren't really into it at all, the same way that people, in the same way that, you know, a prostitute isn't like a lover. I mean, it's the mechanics of it, but it's not really the spirituality of it. And there probably are pro dames or pro subs who would take me to task for that and say, no, I have unique and loving relationships with the men who pay me to do these things to them. And maybe they do, but I don't know.
I've heard some of that before too, yeah. And I don't know, that's the thing. We don't know what really goes on, I guess. The only thing we can really really know about is ourselves, and I'd like to be able to know myself as much as possible. And you know, some of that, I think some of that self-knowledge is maybe asking some of these questions, like why do I enjoy this, you know, why do I like what I like in sex? And maybe the answer is, well, maybe you have trouble coming up with an answer, or maybe it's I like what I like and that's how it is and that's fine. But, you know, it doesn't hurt to ask.
You know, another hard limit that I guess I have that I forgot to mention because it didn't really seem germane, but in this conversation it does, is paying for sex. I am as pro legalization of prostitution as any libertarian could be. I think it should be legal, unregulated, and untaxed, but I have never paid for it and kind of pride myself on that to the point where, like, I remember one time when I'd gone, I think it was about 9 months without sex when I was about 20 one time. It was between girlfriends, and I was in a new city and was, like, not feeling confident and didn't feel like going out to bars, and that was probably the longest period I've ever gone without having sex in my life. And I was actually really flush with cash and living in a neighborhood of prostitution and strip clubs, and I didn't go to either. I just couldn't see doing that. It just seemed like, I think there was some Henry Rollins rant about how, like, people that pay for sex are the people who, in the caveman days, you know, would not have been out hunting. They would have been the men back pounding the corn around the camp with the women. I don't know. It's just like, I guess I just, like, I don't want to be a corn pounder. You know, it just seems very...
I'm having trouble, like, understanding what that means. Like, is he saying that they're emasculated or
I think he was saying that. It was kind of a macho description of it. But it's more like... no, because actually in the hunter-gatherer... in the hunter-tribe situation, I probably would have wanted to be back hanging out with the women while the men are out sweating.
Yeah, why wouldn't you?
You know, and not just to be lazy.
That sounds
but,
like fun.
Because, you know, I'd be probably doing all of them. But,
yeah, have you, by the way, have you read this book, Sex at Dawn? I found it very interesting.
Someone mentioned that. Did you mention that? Someone mentioned that on the Stefan YouTube thread.
I don't comment on YouTube, but maybe, I have mentioned it on my show before.
No, it's about the dawn of sexual civilization, right?
Yeah, it's about, you know, how sexuality evolved and how evolutionary forces kind of shaped it. And it actually talks a lot about sort of like the nature of how peaceful are human beings. Like, are they by nature this violent, aggressive species, or are they really more of a loving or at least cooperative species? And it basically argues for the latter, that they're more cooperative.
Huh.
Yeah, which I think it was a really interesting book. I recommend it.
Have you ever noticed that you said you don't comment on YouTube? Is that because YouTube just has the most heinous, hateful comments of anywhere on the internet?
Yes. Yeah, it stresses me out to even think about reading them, so I just ignore them.
I was wondering the other day, I was trying to figure out why that is, and I think I figured it out. I think it's because YouTube is like a television, and the rest of the internet, YouTube is like TV you can yell back at, whereas the rest of the internet is like a magazine or a book you can talk to. And I think that people who only watch TV and don't read are more likely to yell and be stupid.
I don't know. I have to think on that one some more. But I think anonymity plays a huge role in it for sure.
I use my real name everywhere on the internet, or else use a username that within one or two clicks of searching on Google, you could find out who I am. And I use my full name with my middle initial so people know it's not the other 8 million Michael Deans in the world. Yeah. And I usually use my city. So that's a lot less anonymous than most people are. You know, I use my name and my city. I think if everyone not had to do that, but I think if everyone did that, the internet would be a more polite place.
Yeah, I agree with you, because people are social creatures, you know, and when they when you have that identity or that relationship, I think it does make people more inclined to be polite, or at least like consider that maybe they might run into these people they're commenting to again someday.
I mean, people routinely, minute by minute, all the time on the internet, say things to other people that would get you punched in the nose on any street in the world.
It's an interesting phenomenon, isn't it?
Yeah. Yep.
So back to the whole, okay, I want to talk about the prostitution thing, and then I want to go back to the kink, maybe, unless we're done talking about that.
I'm not done.
But, okay, so for me, I think that, you know, about prostitution, it just doesn't help anybody to have it criminalized. I mean, it really doesn't. It hurts everybody, especially
What does the government do that helps anybody? Everything the government does hurts everybody.
Well, pretty much nothing, yeah. Yeah, definitely. But it's just so damaging. I mean, to put people in jail for making a transaction like that doesn't help.
You know, and I actually think prostitution is one of the few things that are illegal, that if they were legal, they wouldn't be much cheaper. You know, weed would be incredibly far cheaper than it is now if it were legal. But I think prostitution is pretty much at the market value. Yeah.
I guess it depends on how legal it is, I guess, you know, like how many restrictions and how many taxes are going to be on it.
Because in Denmark and Amsterdam and places like that where it's legal, it's not much cheaper than neighboring countries where it's illegal. It's probably a little more so they can pay the taxes on it. But
well, and how much are the laws actually stopping, you know?
None. They actually make more of a market.
Yeah, and I think they really create a pretty dangerous climate for at least some of the women that are like really kind of like enslaved by pimps and really forced into these circumstances.
Yeah, there wouldn't be pimps if prostitution were legal, or they'd all be female and more like business managers.
Yeah, and there are some of those today. The madams, I guess.
Yeah, they'd be like, they'd have a role that's probably more like a theatrical agent for an actor.
Yeah.
Although, would they really be necessary? I mean, I think sex is so saleable that I don't think you really need an agent to present it.
Yeah, maybe not. But maybe they could set up, I don't know, special opportunities or who knows? I don't know. Let the market decide. But
fantasy fuck island.
I just really like to hammer home the point that it's so unhelpful, you know, to try to prohibit it. It's obviously it can't be prohibited.
Agreed.
And the consequences of prohibition are disastrous.
Agreed.
You know, it's not making anybody, you know, the morality police are not supposed to exist in this country either.
Agreed.
You know.
There's a really good book I liked about sex that's called One Nation Under Sex, that's written by Larry Flint and some lawyer, that's about all of the scandals of every politician in America going back to the founding fathers. It's pretty good.
Interesting. That sounds funny. An interesting one.
It's
to
funny.
Check out. Yeah. So, okay, back where were we with the kink thing, because I know you wanted to come back to
it. I didn't necessarily want to come back to it. I'll talk about it.
Well, you said you had a hard limit of paying for sex. Did that thought come up because of something I said?
No, because earlier I'd said my hard limits were animals, children, blood, and scat. And then you were talking about prostitution, and I was like, you know, I think that I could include in that paying for it. I dated a bunch of strippers and a few prostitutes, and would go to the strip club to pick the strippers up after work, and you know, they didn't have a set time of when they got off, so I'd have to hang out there, and I'd usually sit in the DJ booth and talk to the DJ and have a soda. And it just seemed really shallow to me. Now, I like pornography. Maybe it's because I can't see it looking at me going, "You're a sucker." But prostitution and strippers kind of have that effect on me of like, "You're a sucker." I don't know.
You're a sucker. Because why pay for something that you could potentially get for free? Is that
Especially when you're dating the woman and picking her up and at the job. I don't know. It's, you know what?
And so what did they say? What did they say about those work environments? Like, were they happy working there?
Oh, this is San Francisco. They're unionized there. They have benefits. They have health care. The thing that bums me out about strip clubs is the men. They're really creepy guys, and the ones that aren't creepy become creepy there. And generally, the people that hang out at strip clubs are not people I'd want to hang out with. I could tell by just looking at them.
Hmm. Hi, baby. Well, I can't really agree or disagree, because I don't have too much experience, you know, going to strip clubs. But it would seem to me like maybe there are a lot of maybe it would be kind of tough to work in one of those environments and just have to deal with a lot of people just like leering at you and maybe doing other behaviors that you're not totally comfortable with, you know, as a woman.
Hang on a sec. DJ just came in and said, "I have a comment here."
Oh, sure thing.
Okay, what is it? Get up close to the mic, though.
Well, I heard the observation about men at strip clubs being creepy. I have never been more creeped out than going to see women at a strip show.
You mean where men are stripping or women are stripping?
Yes, where men are stripping for women. Women lose all sense of propriety, and I feel that as a woman I can make that statement without sounding too sexist or whatever, but truly, just horrible.
So what were some of the things that you saw them do?
I was embarrassed to be there and be the same gender as the audience.
She can't hear you. I had the headphones on, and I was biting her boob. she was leaning over into the mic. And all the men are gay at those places, too. They're dancing, aren't they? She said, "Who cares?
They look good." That doesn't matter. Yeah,
she said,
exactly. I was kind of curious to ask DJ what were some of the things that she saw people doing at those. Because I've never seen a strip club for women to go to, like, to see men strip.
What do the women do, she wants to know, that are embarrassing? Come back and get up on the mic. Here, I gotta go. I'll take a break. You sit in for me.
The official break has happened. Hello, Stephanie.
Hello, DJ. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. What do the women do? There's something creepy about seeing a woman who could be your elderly aunt, maybe grandmother, shaking her chest and reaching out for the G-string of some 20-something-year-old guy.
So, oh, my.
It's like... No. And, you know, they'd never behave that way anywhere else but at Chippendales or, you know, whatever the place wants to be. But it's...
Do men go to the strip clubs too, or is it just women?
The men that go to bars where men are stripping are so low life. And, you know, they're there cruising for the desperate audience. And I've only been a couple of 2-3 times with, and this was many years ago, with girls that I worked with. And I just said, I can't do this. And I mean, I've gone to strip clubs with women stripping, and the men can be idiots, but there's also a large part of them that aren't. But more women were in the audience were being idiots as a whole. And it's like, okay, and Sunday when you and I run into each other in church, you're not going to make eye contact with me because that's not who you are here.
Wow. And yeah, so you got a sense maybe they weren't really being like genuine, or that's not how they would act in any other context.
Yeah, I started wondering, okay, which is the real you? The one I'm seeing here under this guy's groin, or the one that you are 99% of the time.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, the hidden depths. It's just horrifying.
Do you think it's sort of like an escapism maybe for some people? Like they go there to just let loose because they can't ever let loose otherwise?
Well, sure. And what does that say about our society that, you know, what, women can't whistle at a man? You know, not that I've ever clamored to do that, but I think there is some double standard going on here. And then you get these women who are so repressed, put some alcohol in them, and then dangle lovely young men in front of their face. Yeah, I think there is some, I can't do this anywhere else, so I'm going to do it here. Yeah!
And are there rules in those strip clubs? Like, you can't touch the dancers, or... And do people follow the rules?
They don't touch them, per se, but boy, they're stuffing that money as close to whatever they want to touch as they can.
Yeah.
Which is another kind of ew thing. But, you know, I thought the stripper that came up with the platform shoes that had a piggy bank in the soles was, you know, yeah, sure, come by my feet. That makes sense. Don't touch anything else.
Some people do want to touch the feet, I think, right?
I've known a few of those. You have lovely feet. May I touch them? No. No. But I think Michael's getting antsy and needs his... microphone back.
Okay.
But it was lovely talking with me. You. Just a minute.
Yeah, likewise.
Yo. Let's save the file. It's over 20 minutes here.
Okay.
You're listening to the Anarchy Gumbo podcast. That proves you're smarter than most people.
So I hope you can fix psychology if you enter into psychology, because I think there's problems with it. And I think it's very influenced by and an arm of the state in a lot of ways.
You mean psychiatry, like where they involuntarily keep people at the hospital and kind of give them get lots of drugs, like a lot of its focuses on giving drugs instead of sort of talk therapy?
Yeah, and things like giving drugs to school kids to make them more compliant, and government defining everything as crazy so, you know, they can control more people more. I mean, for an example I can think of is, you know, if you see a psychiatrist for a certain, let's say someone voluntarily committed themselves for a short period of time for depression, that could make it so they can't get a concealed carry permit. You know, the government's like tied in with that, things like that. A lot of things, one of my biggest problems with psychiatry is the definition of the disease, oppositional defiant disorder, because I looked at the DSM, and that just looks like being a libertarian.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think I probably qualify for that diagnosis myself, you know? And the thing that really bothers me is it's like, it's not really based on whether it's a problem for the patient, it's based on whether their teacher, at least ADD and maybe ODD, I haven't looked at it in a while, but they're based on like whether their teachers think they're a problem or whether their parents think they're a problem, you know? And I think in a lot of those cases, pretty much everyone now agrees that those things are way overdiagnosed, if not non-existent, you know what I mean? Like if not, that they really are kind of like made up, you know? And there are some people who say that they focus a lot better when they take Ritalin or whatever, and maybe they do, but at what cost? You know, like how much are you paying and what side effects does it have? And are you kind of missing maybe some underlying issues like, oh, I don't know, school is boring, you know?
DJ just wrote down on a piece of paper and put in front of me, therapist equals the rapist. That's an old one. It's good, though.
I've heard that before. Yeah.
Yep. What were the other problems I had with psychiatry? The fact that BDSM is considered a disorder by modern psychiatry.
Is it considered a disorder? I mean, it's hard to, like, if 60% of people want to be tied up, it's hard to argue that that's now a disorder. You know what I mean? But
want to be tied up or tie someone up or, yeah,
Let me look that up, because I think I've kind of heard this. And from what I understand, it's really only if it's a problem to the patient. Like, you know, if you require something to become aroused or to function sexually, that...
Do you have a DSM-IV in front of you?
I'm about to look it up right now. So... Yeah, it'll take me a minute probably, but
Look up sadomasochism. I think that's what would would be, I think that's what it is under. And I mean, they, you know, psychiatry, you know, 20 years ago, if you went to a psychiatrist and said, I'm attracted to people of my sex, they'd say, well, you need years and years of therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that was proven to be complete bunk, right? I mean, the American Psychological Association renounced that in the 1970s, as far as I understand it. And now they're like very supportive of gay marriage, you know, like they're trying to be very queer friendly and supportive of LGBT folks. And I think that kind of goes to show how arbitrary some of these diagnoses are. Like, it's basically decided by a committee of psychologists and psychiatrists that get together, and then they decide, okay, well, what are the disorders and what defines them? And it's supposed to be the DSM-IV, this manual where people can go and look up what the disorders are and what the criteria are. A lot of the diagnostic criteria are kind of vague, you know, and it's like pick three out of the five, and if they have three out of the five, then they have this disease. And it's supposed to be used kind of for research purposes, but it's been used a lot to diagnose people. And
I call it the big book of crazy.
The big book of crazy, right. Well, I mean, in Soviet Russia, look at what they had as disorders. You know, anti-authoritarianism, like it challenging the government was a disorder and could get you committed and, you know, probably treated with drugs non-consensually.
I think they're headed that way here, and they definitely use psychiatry in Nazi Germany. You know, which is not to say it's bad. I mean, they also used agriculture in Nazi Germany. I think a lot of the problem with a lot of systems that do some good is when they become an industry or a business. I mean, it's kind of like Nima likes to say, you know, if you ask your barber if you need a haircut, he's going to say yeah. And I think that with psychiatry, if you go in with anything, they're going to say, yeah, you probably need some therapy.
I don't know about that. I mean, maybe sometimes therapy should be something that's fun and enjoyable, and that maybe not fun, but at least helpful, you know?
Yeah.
Right? That helps, yeah. That has the goal of focusing on helping the person, right, have a happier life. And it shouldn't be something that's forced, of course. That's not going to work. If somebody doesn't want to be in therapy, they're not going to get much out of it. But I don't even think most psychiatrists recommend therapy. I think they mostly just focus on drugs. And that's probably not benefiting the patients, you know, as much as it could.
Which is probably, you know, which is because it's an industry. It's because it's tied into big pharma, and it's because it's tied into insurance, to where people pay for it with insurance, and insurance only gives you 8 sessions, and in 8 sessions, they can't do much other than give you drugs.
Yeah, yeah. So I looked up the DSM-IV criteria, and there's a section about paraphilias, which paraphilias are basically kinks. And so what
paraphilia means unusual sexuality, which is, you know, again, if it's 60% of all people, is it really unusual? But go on.
Yeah, and would they even define that as kinky? I don't know if they would, you know.
But what does it say?
So the list, the things that they list as paraphilias are exhibitionism, fetishism, frauderism, which is basically like, isn't that like rubbing
on
yourself
people
on somebody
that's
who doesn't consent, right? Isn't that like a big...
I don't know that it involves a not consenting.
Wikipedia says a non-consenting person for sexual gratification. Rubbing against a non-consenting person. So, okay. I mean, if that was taking place, like, that's actually a violation
of
the non-aggression principle, right? That's because the person doesn't consent. And so maybe...
But what were the first two?
The first two were exhibitionism, and they also have voyeurism on there, too. Fetishism, which means that there's something that's some object or something that's required for somebody to be sexual, right? And pedophilia is in there, which they, you know, I don't know if they, and then sexual masochism and sadism are both on there as well. So that's what, I guess, what you were referring to.
Yeah, I mean, take out the non-consensual rubbing and the pedophilia, and I think everything else you described would definitely fit under BDSM and would fit under things I've been interested in. And
what if it's exhibitionism with somebody who's not consenting, or voyeurism with somebody who's not consenting?
I didn't even go there. I thought of in front of your lover, or I used to do a podcast with DJ where we had sex, slappy sex, and then talked about it. And that was a form of exhibitionism. And nobody heard it who didn't want to hear it. I would assume, you know, there was a, you must be of legal age to view this site and, or listen to the site, and you had to click through it. And, yeah, I never played it out my window over speakers for my neighbors.
Yeah.
I also, I don't like the definition of fetishism as, you know, an attraction to an object that is required, because certain objects or clothings or things like that can enhance a couple or a triad's enjoyment of things, but they're not required. You know, it's not like, I can't get off if you're not wearing pumps, but if she is wearing pumps, I like it better, you know? Is that
so
a
fetish? That would not be a fetish under their definition.
Well, under their definition, but under the common definition, if you type the word fetish into Google, you're not going to get anything psychological about needing something. You know, it's going to be, I don't know.
Yeah, I think there are probably two different senses. And what this Wikipedia article says is, if a sexual fetish causes significant psychosocial distress for the person or has detrimental effects on important areas of their life, it is diagnosable as a paraphilia in the DSM, and many people embrace their fetish rather than attempting to treat or rid themselves of it. So they're emphasizing that it has to be a problem for the person and they have to be bothered by it.
So sick fucks like me, instead of seeking therapy, deal with it and find other sick fucks and marry them, I guess is what they're saying.
Well, then you're not sick, right? Because it's not a problem for
you. Well, yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about that. If it's a problem, I'm thinking, like, a lot of times with people, if it's a problem, it's probably because of societal, you know, controls or demands. Like, I'm thinking of, DJ and I go to a lot of church flea markets in our town because that's where you get the bargains in Wyoming. You go to the church flea markets and they have them like once a month, and they're like social affairs with, you know, cookies and every, I mean, they're great. It's like Porcfest for Christians or something. And we are not Christian by any stretch of the imagination, but we love going to these church flea markets because they have these mega churches here with, you know, giant places, and they'll have these flea markets with, you know, 200 booths in them every once a month, and we go to them. And in the church lobby, they'll have, and we've been to a few different churches and seen this, in the church lobby, they have listings of the church programs that they have. A lot of these mega churches, you know, they don't just have Sunday service. It's like it becomes your government practically. Like it becomes your community, you know. And they have lists of all the different seminars and like couples counseling and children's counseling and teen counseling and job, you know, filling out resume classes and everything. And all of these churches have a couple classes on, one is dealing with pornography addiction. And, you know, one is dealing with, like, weird sexual feelings or whatever. And I would assume that
including
would be...
Including being gay?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's another one. But no, and I'm imagining that must be, you know, if you really want your wife to dress up a certain way in bed, you need to come to this class and get right with God. And it's a combination of, like, therapy and religion. And... You know, I mean, I'm like, what is pornography?
I wouldn't consider that therapy. I mean, because they're probably just guilting people, right?
Yeah, yeah. And
so that kind of adds to their misery. What they really need is a, what is it called? An agony aunt, right?
Yeah, yeah. And I'm thinking, like, what is
there'll be an agony after going to their church thing.
And I'm thinking, like, what is pornography addiction? You know, I think it's relative. I mean, I think I probably look at enough pornography to that if I were in that church, well, probably any pornography in that church, they'd send you to that class. But it's like, it doesn't get in the way of my life in any way. I do not look at child porn. And I work at home, so it's not getting in the way of my job.
Well, you know, to me, that's the most important thing is it a problem in your life? Is it something that you want to change? And if you do, then there are tools out there. I actually talked about this on my show like a couple weeks ago. We did like a whole hour about porn addiction because I came across this really interesting website called Your Brain on Porn that basically came at it from an evolutionary perspective and said, you know, our brains are not really meant for the deluge of porn that's out there and how easy it is to access and how much novelty we can experience. It kind of desensitizes us to a real partner in some cases, you know, and it's not as exciting in real life. And if that becomes a problem for you, you're the only one that can decide that, but if it becomes a problem for you, there are ways to help, and here's how, and here's what other people have had success with. So they're really coming at it from a very sort of non-judgmental perspective. Like, you have to decide that this is something you're interested in, and if you're interested, here's what other people have done, and here's not advice, but basically experience that you can read about. But you know, if it's not a problem for you, then there you go. There's your answer, right?
Yeah, I think a lot of times it's probably where someone would seek counseling or be told by their pastor to seek counseling. It's probably because their partner doesn't like it. Whereas, you know, my only problem with pornography with my wife is she likes a different type of pornography than I do, but we each have our own computers, so it's fine.
I'm kind of curious.
Oh, I
well,
like...
maybe I shouldn't ask.
Well, I... okay, I generally... You know, most of the porn on my hard drive is women... Plump women between 40 and 50 in lingerie doing really, really, really filthy things. Okay. With men, where you don't see the men's face. Her pornography is generally a woman between 18 and 80 who has about five penises shoved into various orifices in her body. That's what she likes. So...
Okay.
And, you know, a lot of what we would do, you know, it doesn't diminish our sex life. It gives us ideas.
Yeah.
Not that I'd invite four other men into the bed, but, you know, we have, you know, devices to represent them if that's ever needed. So,
mm-hmm.
Boy, how did we go to this place?
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, speaking of giving people ideas, I mean, isn't that sort of the, I guess, the point of fantasy or the point of exploring things like porn is like to, you know, just maybe experience a little bit of something different. And if you want to take some of those ideas into real life, maybe, but maybe you just want to think about them. I don't know.
Did you ever see the book, The Joy of Sex, that book from the 60s?
Yeah, I'm familiar with that book. Yeah.
That book was a bestseller because it gave people ideas of things to try that they didn't know about. I know the word frottage from that book. And in that book, it didn't describe it as, you know, it said it's something to do with your partner. It didn't have any implication of, forcing it, assault. But that book was a bestseller because vanilla couples who had no idea what they could do, and pornography was hard to get a hold of, expensive, boring, and or illegal in the 60s in America. So that book was stuff to do with your partner to spice things up. That book is about the tamest piece of crap I've ever seen. I mean, if you put that on my desk right now, I would be like, that's in my way. I'm going to use that to hold up this monitor that's kind of tipping on one side, you know?
Yeah, it's interesting how things have changed over time. I mean, I remember recently I was reading a blog post from somebody who maybe worked at the Museum of Sex, which is like in Paris, I think. And she was saying that basically there was this anatomist in Italy back in like the 1700s when they were just sort of starting to write down all the things that they were learning about human anatomy and draw pictures, and you know, the famous anatomy books were coming out. And this guy, the clitoris wasn't in any of these books. Like, it was omitted from all of the anatomical drawings.
Wow.
And this one guy thought he had discovered it for the first time. Like, he was like, I don't know, he was finding it on all these women, and he was like, huh, I didn't see this in the pictures. And then he would, you know, touch it or something, and they would go, ooh. And and then so he wrote about it, and he drew it, and he was like, I've discovered this new thing that's not in any of the books. Well, guess where he ended up? In jail.
Yeah, I was going to say mental institution, but yeah, jail.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, that just shows how hard people have been trying for so long to repress sexuality, and particularly in women, and to shame them for it, and to make it go away. But of course, it hasn't gone away by any means, you know. And I think if you repress it, or if you try to repress it, then it's going to come out inevitably in some ways. You know, we might as well just acknowledge that it exists, and it's a healthy part of being human. You know, and sex is fun. There's nothing wrong with being adventurous about it, right?
Worms.
There you go.
So are you a gun person? A gun gal?
A little bit, not particularly. I've shot a lot of different guns before, and I have a few, but it's not like a huge part of my life.
Do you carry one?
I'm not going to say. Let people wonder.
All right. There you go. You know, a lot of psychiatrists think that if you have a lot of guns, you have problems.
A lot of psychiatrists are coming from the perspective of, you know, basically
California.
I read this article a couple weeks ago called Diagnosing Anti-Authoritarianism, and I think it was by Bruce Levine, who's a psychologist or PhD psychologist, and so maybe a clinical psychologist. And he was saying that basically most people, doctors, psychologists, psychiatrists, people who are professionals, get to where they are by being extremely conformist. And I can speak for this firsthand, that the culture of medicine is extremely conformist. You know, it's very, very stifling in some ways, you know, if you are an anti-authoritarian or if you are a nonconformist. And so the people who end up getting to these positions where they are the ones deciding who has pathology are the people who have gotten to where they are by just following all the rules and being, quote, good or obedient, you know? And so, of course, they're going to say things like having, you know, like being an anti-authoritarian or being a nonconformist or whatever. Of course, they're going to think that those things are pathologies when they're really just a type of normal. You know, I think there's a wide range of normal in human personality and behavior and interests and stuff like that.
Worms. Mm. Worms. So we're almost out of time here. I've had a great time, and I ask a boring question to some people of all my interviewees or people I chat with on here.
Okay.
It's about audio gear.
That doesn't sound boring to me. It kind of excites me, actually.
The reason I ask people about audio gear is because it interests me, but also because one of my goals is to improve the quality of all Liberty media out there. So I think I ask people what they use, so anybody listening who wants to start a podcast or wants to do a radio show can have some insight into what the good-sounding podcast people do.
Yeah, thank you. So you consider me among the good sounders, huh?
Yeah, cool. And one of the few people who was willing to do a double-ender podcast. Let's talk about a double-ender first.
Oh,
and that's
yeah.
not some sex act. It's not a sex
say.
Act. It's basically, we're talking over Skype, over Mumble, but we're not recording Mumble. I have a microphone in front of me that's going to a second computer and recording, and you have the same thing on your end, and then you're going to send me your files, and I'm going to sync them up and edit them together. And that is really the way to get the best possible audio of two people who are not in the same room. It's kind of the audio equivalent of like when you're watching Fox or CNN and they have a split screen and they have two people in different locations talking. It's kind of the same idea, but it's with audio only.
Yeah, yeah.
So what are you recording with, and is it what you usually use to record your show with?
Yes, this is, I'm in the Porc Therapy studio, which basically is...
Isn't that your attic? I've seen a picture of it.
Yeah, and I think you commented that you liked seeing all the junk in the background and the unfinished look, because it was like, hey, you know, we're all just kind of podcast comrades and we're doing this in our basements and our attics, and it's kind of has that intimate feel to it, I guess. It's not like we're in some professional studio. We're all like, you know, we're all in this world that nobody can break into. No, it's easy to become a podcaster, and pretty much anyone can do it who's willing to learn about it, you know. So I guess to answer your question of what I'm recording with, I use an AT2020 microphone, and it's an XLR connection to
mix. Is that a condenser mic?
Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm. So it's fan empowered.
Yes, by my mixer.
Yeah.
And the mixer that I use is a Behringer X1204, I think. It's got a couple different channels, and the setup that I use for Porc Therapy is I have one computer running Skype. And I take calls on Skype, and I have what you have actually, which is a Skype online number, and the 419 PT Love 4, which is the number for my show, forwards to that, and so I can take calls on both Skype and phones through this computer, and then they can hear me because my main mix goes out to Skype, and then basically the mix of the computer running Skype and my voice goes out to Mumble, which transmits it to the Liberty Radio Network, and then they play the music beds, so that's on their end, but everything else is on my end.
Nice. And you, what program are you recording into?
Audacity, which is totally free.
It's free
and easy to learn about.
Yep.
Yeah.
And what kind of computer are you using?
I just have a little netbook, actually. It's just like a cheap netbook, and it works just fine.
And that doesn't crash or anything?
No, it's great. It's actually very stable.
I use the netbook for Skype, but I don't when we're doing the live show, but I use a more powerful desktop computer for recording like we're doing now, because I'm always afraid that a netbook doesn't have enough memory and it'll crash.
I put some extra memory in this, actually, when I got it, yeah.
Yeah, because netbooks generally have like a gig, if that.
Yeah.
Is it Windows or Mac?
It's Windows. I use XP.
Or I should say, what's the operating system? Because it could be Linux. I mean, that's kind of like saying, are you a Republican or a Democrat?
Yeah, exactly. There's a third option, or more than three. But no, you know, I've tried to figure out Linux before, and I wasn't very successful.
Me neither,
like,
man.
I just remember I installed it, and I was trying to put in a DVD so I could do a yoga workout or something like that. And I was like, I couldn't figure out how to open the drive. And I was like, oh, God damn it, you know. And so I realized eventually I had to, like, type in a command line to get it to open, and that was like, okay, that's enough. I'm going.
I know a bunch of people that swear by Linux and think I'm some kind of charlatan because I'm using Windows PCs. But
yeah, I feel conflicted about it myself.
I don't.
Michael,
I don't.
It's like,
I don't.
Really?
Yeah. Here's first of all, you know,
they're so intellectual property, though. I mean, it's
yeah. But you know what?
Know.
Those people that complain about using Windows are running Linux on computers made by giant corporations that are covered by a million different patents and intellectual properties. And, you know, they're writing their anti-authoritarian...
Well, that's true.
They're writing their anti-authoritarian punk rock songs on guitars made by giant corporations.
Also true, yeah.
And the thing with me is, Linux has its uses. For one thing, it's way more secure and doesn't leave little breadcrumbs of everything you've ever searched or done that forensic whoever could look in your hard drive and see what you've done on Windows. But... and it's more extensible if you're willing to put the time into it and you have the mind for it. I don't have the mind for it, and I would rather be creating media than figuring out what command lines to type and feeling, and yeah, you know, I don't feel any less pure. So there.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, it's like we all have to find that line, right? Like we all have to, we can try as hard as we can to live a liberty-friendly life or a pure life or whatever you want to say. I don't want to say pure. That sounds kind of judgmental. But like we can all try as much as we can to avoid dealing with the state, to pay as few taxes as we possibly can, to, you know, to be as free from them as possible. But at the end of the day, that sometimes gets really hard, and it sometimes compromises other things that we want to do. So we kind of just have to decide where our line is, you know?
Yeah.
It's not going to be a perfect... it's going to be really hard to live in a perfect... libertarian world where you completely don't deal with the state, so you kind of got to pick and choose what you want to compromise on.
Yeah, you'd have to go live in a cave, and there's no internet in a cave.
That's true. That's true. I might like to. You know, I've been interested in the paleo diet. I started eating paleo about a year ago. More like a year and a half actually. And I actually had this like skin allergy on my hands. They were like getting allergic to everything, and switching to paleo diet completely cured it. It's amazing. And you know, a couple other little health things that I've noticed that have really improved since I started eating it. But a lot of people who are interested in paleo diet are libertarians, because they start to think about, well, you know, all the stuff that the government is telling me to eat, like bread, and they're telling me to like avoid fat and things like
that.
You
mean the Monsanto diet? It's the opposite of the Monsanto diet. Yeah.
Yeah, that's very accurate, actually. I mean, like, so many of these things that maybe aren't in our best interest health-wise are subsidized by the state, and so we end up eating a lot of them because they're in everything, right? And, like, corn and soy and corn oil and high-fructose corn syrup and wheat and everything.
Mm.
So
you're describing my diet.
Oh, yeah? Well, I mean, there are a lot of people who are interested in sort of eating more natural foods and eating, like, trying to work with our genetics basically to be as healthy as possible, and you know, with what we can eat in a modern world that's as natural as we can. But you know, a lot of these people just start to think about, like, well, hey, if the government's telling me these things about food that aren't really in my best interest, like, what else are they telling me that isn't in my best interest? And
everything. There's somebody, I don't know if it's Lou Rockwell or who, but there's somebody, some libertarian rock star, who says, do everything the opposite of what the government tells you to do, and you'll be okay.
Yeah, and I think there's some grains of truth to that, because they're so backwards on everything. You know, their incentives are really messed up. But I don't subscribe to doing things against the government just simply because the government says it, because that sort of seems like maybe like knee-jerk.
I think it's kind of half joking but half serious.
Yeah, I get it. I think I get it now. So yeah, I mean, I think if you look into a lot of the things that the government is telling you to do, if you really look into the science, or if you think about them a little more carefully, then you'll realize that they're, you know, you may want to do the opposite, right?
Yeah.
But those things show themselves. They become evident if you think about it.
So I think that's all the questions I have, unless you got some closing statement.
Well, thank you for having me on the show, Michael. I enjoyed talking with you.
Thank you very much for coming on. I really enjoyed it. It was good.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a fun one. And it's cool that you started this podcast. It's just sort of like a little hobby, isn't it?
Yeah, Freedom Fiends is my main thing. And it's just I have a little more free time than Nima, and I get kind of stir crazy in the middle of the night and want to do more podcasts a week than the two we're doing. So I started this.
Yeah, what is, are you, do you have trouble sleeping, or are you just have a you can freeform make your schedule how you want?
It's,
what is it?
It's both. I have worked my whole life to have my own schedule, which I've had for the past 10 years, made a living working at home doing media stuff. Because I have a weird sleep schedule. I don't really have insomnia. I say I do, but there's actually a term for what I have, and I can't open up the internet or this recording will crash to find out what it is, but it's there's a name for this disorder, and it's something to the effect of, like, your circadian rhythm is not in a 24-hour stretch.
Oh, yeah, I see.
You know,
yeah.
Like, I generally sleep 8 hours in any 24-hour period, but it can be anywhere from 9 to 5, 9 in the morning till 5 in the afternoon. You know, I go to sleep, put it this way, if one of my friends calls me, there is a 50-50 chance I'll be awake or asleep when they call me, no matter when they call me.
I see. Hmm. Yeah, I'm just looking this up about, because now I'm really curious about what it might be called. They have a longer circadian rhythm. Oh, well, I'll find the answer later, but thanks for sharing. That's interesting.
All right. Thanks again.
Yeah, thanks, Michael. This was really fun.
Cool.
And take care.
Worms.
Worms.
Thank you for listening to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Subscribe at kittyfeet.com. That's kittyfeet.com. All with a rotating guest on a spit, barbecued for your pleasure.
Outtakes, yay.